all grew up in so many different places. Who knew? So would love to center us in some. Megan, what's up, Antonia? Please introduce yourselves if you wouldn't mind in chat. Daughter is beautiful. Good afternoon. Please introduce yourself on the chat. Names, pronouns, affiliation. What brought you here today? Today we're going to ask you guys to take a time traveling trip into the future, right? Create the world that's more compelling than simply what's wrong with this one. So what brought you here today? What are you trying to see in this beautiful world? Whew, it's a tough time. And also, where did you grow up? Share what you feel comfortable with sharing. It's a community invitation to just try to be in community the best virtual way we know how. Thank you, Yuli. We've got some folks. What's up? Oh, okay, Camille, little Brooklyn. All right. Always continued blessings to Craig. Taj, press is, what is press? Parents, racial equity and something, social sciences. No, what does press stand for? I was just riffing on what I thought it could be. Parents for Responsive, Equitable, Safe Schools. Thank you. Oh, thank you, Yuli, as well. Press NYC, got it. Parents for, is it a citywide coalition? Give me a thumbs up. Okay, yes, citywide coalition, awesome. Yes, I've heard of it. I had to be brave and ask what it stood for. I've heard of it, but I wanted to be sure. All right, well, people are still coming in like by the moment, so let's just give it a moment. We're introducing ourselves to those who just got here. What's up, y'all? My name is Sadie. Nice to see y'all. I represent the DOE. I'm also a public school graduate and public school parent, and executive director of the Family and Community Empowerment Office. So I'm here in all the capacities because we love to bring our humanity into our spaces. Please introduce yourself if you haven't already. Welcome, Paulette. Welcome, Craig. Yes, the growing power of parent voices brings you here. I love that. Hello, Erica. Hello, Kristen. What's up, Jamie? What's up, Zach? Zach Mack, what a name. Zach Mack, can't go back to whack. And what else? And Melanie, what's up? All right, so it is 3:03. And I want us to get started. Camille, do we have everybody, or just Taj, do we have everyone? Oh, Executive Superintendent Karen Watts, what a blessing, hello.
I believe all of our panelists are here now, so very exciting, we can get started.
Great, so I'm gonna just lower this. We're listening to La India, Yemaya y Oshun, two deities. who represent the ocean and fertility and motherhood and destruction and sweetness and love and all of the good things that we are trying to be in service of today. Please, if you haven't already, put your, if the Guyanese are here, it's a good day. Put your name in chat, your pronouns, your affiliation, what brought you here today, and then maybe where you grew up, just so that we know where folks grew up, where people are hailing from. I know we're all representing New York City, but also if we're embodying an integrated space, a full humane space, let's see what's up. What's up, Melanie? It's been too long. I'm gonna hand it over to Taj. There she is. Beautiful to be in community with you all. And again, this series was a collaboration brought to you by Bureaucrats for Black Lives. Bureaucrats for Black Lives is a crew of central employees at the New York City Department of Education who came together from all across different divisions and offices to stand in service of what we're trying to see, which is education for liberation, which came together and sort of crystallized itself as an organization during the summer after the countless murders of our fellow Black Americans at the hands of police. The pain of mass shootings and other murders at the hands of the police is not lost on me. The loss of jobs and safety and lives is also not lost on me. So we enter this space tenderly. We enter this space imperfectly, but totally committed to advancing equity and excellence for all our young people, for dismantling institutional racism. But that also means not just to take everything down, but also to build the future that we want to see. And so that's why we're here today. If you have gotten here, you have arrived at part three. We did our past, our present, and now we're here in our future. And our future is in the hand of a growing body of parent voices and student voices. So without further ado, Taj, why don't you introduce yourself and take it away? Thank you, guys.
Hey, y'all, Taj here. I hope my audio is okay. In true New York City mom fashion, I am rushing home from the park with my babies so that I can be present for you all. So it might be a little noisy for a second, but I'm ecstatic to be in community with you all today as a part of this series. My name is Taj and I'm the Community Education Council President in District 14, which covers Bushwick, Greenpoint, Williamsburg, and a little sliver of Bed-Stuy. I'm also the program manager at Teens Take Charge and a steering committee member with Black Lives Matter at School and Parents for Responsive, Equitable, Safe Schools. I'm also the comms director at Students Break the Silence, which is a student-led advocacy coalition working to decriminalize queer, disabled, and young people of color in our public schools. I'm really excited to be a moderator today, and I would actually love to give our panelists the opportunity to introduce themselves if everyone is here. We can go ahead and start with, let's see. I will start with Miss Erica Kendall. I want to give you guys the opportunity to let the people know who you are as well before we get into the panel. So I'll hand it off to Erica first.
Dang, I thought I could sneak in. All right, so good afternoon, everyone. My name is Erica Kendall. I'm a member of CEC 17 in Central Brooklyn. My pronouns, of course, are she, Ceres, a mom of two and a advocate and proponent of equity and just making sure that all these babies find some way and space to thrive in this world. Thank you.
Thank you, Erica. And we know that and we see that and we appreciate you. I'm going to hand it off next to Naquan.
Good afternoon, Naquan. Good afternoon, Naquan McLean. I'm the parent of four Black beautiful children who all was born and raised in Bed-Stuy, Brooklyn. I am the president of CEC 16. I am the co-chair of the Education Council Consortium for the City of New York, and I'm glad to be in community with you all today.
I'm over here messing around in the chat like I'm not the moderator. That's just my energy. I'm in here like Brooklyn in the chat instead of unmuting y'all. So that just know that's the energy you're going to get today. It's going to be a little informal, but a whole lot of love, okay? I'm going to pass it off next to Camille.
Hi, everybody. Thank you, Taj. I am Camille Casaretti. I'm the president of the District 15 Community Education Council. I have two children in the public school system. I was born in Brooklyn, grew up in Brooklyn, went to public schools in Brooklyn, and I am so excited to be with you all today and in the presence of just such extraordinary people. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Camille. Next, I'm going to hand it off to Abby.
Hello, everyone. My name is Abby Anderson. I'm Community Education Council, District 23 president. I was raised in Brooklyn. I was raised in Queens. And I have grandchildren in D23 and also a son in D23.
Thank you so much. I'm going to just jump in just in case Taj is in the middle of momming while Zooming. What other panelists did not introduce themselves?
Sadie, I know Miriam is here.
Oh, great. Thank you. See, we got to hold each other. Miriam, come on off mute, introduce yourself. If the spirit moves you to show your face on video, that's cool too, but no pressure. We've all been zoomed out for the last 14 minutes.
Yes, no worries. If there's a tech issue, Miriam, feel free to let us know in the chat if there's an issue with your mic or if you just need a second.
Hi, Taj. I had some problems. Is it my turn to talk?
It is. No worries. We have all been there. Yes, we would love to hear.
I had some technical problems. So.
No worries. We have all been there. Go ahead and introduce yourself.
Introduce myself. Hello, everyone. I'm Dr. Miriam Benchek Ellis. I'm a parent of five children, all in the public system. And public schools, I mean. I'm part of the CC District 13, and I have kids in different districts, District 22, 13, and 15. And I'm very happy and honored to be here with this group this afternoon.
Thank you, Miriam. And we will all always hold space for tech difficulties. It's been a year and it still happens, y'all. And that's all right. Thank you for being here with us today. And thank you to our now over 60 guests who are here for this third installment of the DOE Teach-In. We are actually going to jump right in. Thank you, Sadie, for the beautiful framing. And thank you to you all for the workshops. It's a lot of help to move the work forward. So let's get into it, y'all. The first question that I want to ask you all is, what are your recommendations for building collective value in the classroom? And what tools are required to bring an empathetic and anti-racist school culture to fruition? And I'm going to start out with Abby.
Hello again, everyone. My recommendation will be centered on the, on the curricular value in the classroom. Wait. And the use of collegial responses, text to ensure understanding and empathy. And also, the reality of the work of promoting empathy and tolerance begins the moment we ourselves are ready to figure it out as much passion as we plot towards improving their academics.
Thank you, Abby, and bless you, Abby. And we appreciate you. Absolutely. Yes, I love what you said about culturally responsive education and thinking about how we can support students culturally and not just think about grades, right? I also want to pass this question to Naquan. What are your recommendations for building collective value in the classroom, and what tools are required to bring empathetic and anti-racist school culture to fruition?
Thank you. Good question, Taj. I first think that we have to identify that we have a racist system before we can do anything. And then the recommendations would be teacher and development. And not only teacher development, but from the core of all of our staff and schools being, you know, we sometimes don't like to use the word train, but for lack of better words, that's the word I'm going to use today. Trained on, you know, what, how to make an environment, a school environment safe, but not also safe, but where people feel like they belong there. So often we throw out, you know, the deal we have a couple of years ago, maybe 1 or 2 years ago, the PEP voted on the definition for culturally responsive pedagogy, but you have not seen any implementation of it as of yet. And I think what we need to do is make sure that we don't only vote on these things, but we get the tools that this families need inside of the school. So not only training our teachers on it, but also informing our parents about it. You have so many parents that doesn't understand the difference or what this means. And I think that will be the recommendation I make with this question is how do we develop our parents and our staff to understand the importance of having empathy in this time and out of this time for students when we're going through a time as this.
Thank you, Juan, 100%. You bring up a really great point about, like, yes, we're attempting to develop staff, but what does it look like to develop and support families and moving through this work to help us co-create a system that is no longer racist? And thank you for naming that, Naquan, in the space, because that also has to be where we begin, right? If we are not clear on the fact that the system is entrenched with oppressive systems, then we will both intentionally and unintentionally recreate those systems. So thank you for your clarity, Naquan. I'm gonna move on to another question. But also, guys, if you feel inclined or if something's really on your heart, please feel free to step in. You don't have to only answer the questions that you're called on for. If something is moving you or you have something to say, we want to hear from you, okay? So our next question is going to be for Ms. Erica Kendall. Because just in thinking about the pandemic, there are some very specific issues that certain communities were dealing with way before the pandemic that have only been exacerbated. And within the context of desegregation, something that we don't often talk about is school climate, which is what Naquan brought forth, but it's also resource equity, right? Because putting a bunch of children into a building is a piece, right? But there's so much that goes along with it. And in the context of this year, we really need to be thinking about what we have to make up for and what we need to restore. So I want to ask the excellent Ms. Kendall. You know I'm a big fan, sis. You already know. In communities that have experienced decades-long divestment, how can we improve technological connectivity and access to high-quality working devices?
Right. So I think first and foremost, you make broadband free, like, period. You know, this is a conversation not just about communication, but really about the economy. There are so many people who could use access to the internet to create not only economic opportunity for their families, creating small businesses and using social media to connect to people who might could take advantage of what it is they're offering, but also making it very easy for schools to reach out to them. You know, one of the things that I realized once my daughter reached high school was the parent coordinator changed the way that she was connecting to families, because at this point now the kids have devices. So how many kids have devices where you can take a picture of a flyer or take a picture of whatever report the parent coordinator wants to give and send that picture to the child? And then the child also now has the ability to connect with the information with the parent. Or now you've got schools that have the requirement of making sure every student has an email address. Use that to connect to the parent. Make sure the parent has a device that is a smartphone. You know, they give away phones to people. The phones are not always tech. They're not always smartphones. They're not phones that can always process pictures, things of that nature. Take advantage of that. Give these people these phones. Like, we turn in phones every year to get a new phone. Somebody's turning in a phone to get a new phone. Create a program or a system that puts those older devices in the hands of families who might not be able to afford a smartphone on their own. Put those devices in their hands and use them as a means of being able to connect that family to what's going on with their child in the DOE. Most importantly, I reiterate, make broadband free. Like, I understand, like, now all of a sudden, all the CECs, all the elected officials are talking about broadband and internet access. Now it's real easy to make sure everybody gets $15 a month internet access. That's still too much money. For something that now at this point is a utility, that's too much money. That doesn't make sense. So in my mind, we advance the technology, but we advance our ability to connect to families by investing in the technology, investing in broadband, making it free, making sure that every family has access to a smartphone that can not only use photos, but also makes it easier to connect via email. Also, invest in the kind of apps and resources that provide language support. There are so many different apps now that will translate something in a picture or translate something someone's saying to you. I've had to use this to connect with the building superintendent for my apartment. You go ahead, speak in the language that's most comfortable to you. This device will translate it for me in live and in person, and then I can use it to talk back to you. If a family is receiving emails, if they can't translate it, invest in the kind of technology that will make that translation more accessible to them. Or invest in making sure that every family has a device that can translate the information coming from their schools. Or maybe parent coordinators could invest the energy into making sure that they know, okay, I have a certain list of families that speak Bangla. I have a certain list of families that speak Creole. Okay, these families are going to receive all of our notifications from the school in Creole. And then invest in and then take that seriously. I think, you know, one of the upsides to what has been an absolute trash year is that so many families got devices. Now it's about investing in the resources that are going to increase connectivity for every child. And I think that this is the first way to do it. And I'll say one more time, nobody should be paying hundreds of dollars for internet access when now it's essentially incumbent upon every family to have it so that their children can even access school, let alone do well in it.
Thank you so much, Erica. And we can't amplify that enough. Free broadband, y'all. 70% of New York City public school children are currently remote. It makes no sense that any of those families are paying to access the internet that they need to go to school every single day. A year later, this is not even a request. It never should have been a request we had to make, but a year later, we certainly shouldn't still be in a position where we have to ask for this resource that the entire city is utilizing just to function. So thank you so much, Erica. I'm going to pivot a little bit because Erica brought up a couple of different really critical points, one of which was language access, and just kind of thinking about Erica's thinking.
without the resources provided to us, we've had to do it ourselves, right? A lot of our local CECs have been doing everything from delivering groceries to delivering donated devices, right? And so when we talk about segregation and when we talk about the pandemic and when we think about what it looks like to shift the system in a way that we create the conditions for all children to thrive, one of the things I love to do, and I'm so happy that this panel is full of parent leaders, is that you look at best practices, right? You look at what's going on in the community because expertise exists there. You might not necessarily need to pay $1,000 for a certain kind of workshop when the parents in your community are invested and also have the knowledge, right, to provide what a school community needs with the structural support to back them up. And so just kind of piggybacking off Erica, and anyone who wants to can jump in, but I'm going to pivot to Camille first. That has me thinking, how can the DOE support authentic people power, student voice, and foster true parent partnership rather than performative engagement that only reaches a handful of parents? And just a follow-up question for everyone to think about, what is at stake if there is no inclusive, accessible outreach and collaboration with our most deeply impacted educators, students, and families? Camille, go ahead.
Taj, thank you. Thank you so much for that question. I just want to uplift and thank the people who are constantly bringing up the D15 diversity plan and the work that we did in District 15. But I'd also like to acknowledge that our district does not reflect the diversity of New York City. It's a district or an example of the difference between equal and equality. So I want people to recognize that we did spend a lot of time. We had great people working with us. We have made shifts, but what we did in District 15 doesn't necessarily apply to every single district in New York City, and it won't apply to a lot of them. And we need to be very conscious and aware that communities that are deeply segregated are that way through intentionally racist policies that have been in effect since before I was born, and you know, we all were. And we really need to work actively to dismantle that. And so there have to be multiple ways that we are supporting our schools, and desegregating where we can, when we can, has to be a priority, but it cannot be the only measure. There really need to be other systems in place. So with that said, I will just get to more of the question about supporting authentic people power. And I think that part of this idea really comes from the moment that you walk into a school building. If you have a sense of welcome, being welcomed there, I think that that really sets the stage for whatever could be the best possible relationship that you might be able to have. And so I think that all of the experiences that we have as parents really shape how we feel about the schools that our children are in. And I can't stress the importance of just seeing people, saying hello, you know, not like turning your head when somebody's walking by, and this just feels and sounds like that's just basic information. But in many spaces, it doesn't work like that. So I really think it's important to just sort of like set the stage for a welcoming environment. I think that in many schools, we've seen a lot of success with small group sessions where either administration was leading conversations about equity and race, or maybe small groups in the PTA. Oftentimes those kind of conversations could come out of a wellness committee. And it's really important to have safe space for these conversations. SLTs really have a strong role to play in desegregating and creating supports for all of their community members. It's important to be on the same page, and because if the administrators and school staff and parents are all sort of divided in their mentality, then you really start hitting a lot of walls. And what I can say in District 15 is that we have had a lot of success with bringing community members together to share stories, to really find out what people are looking for in their schools, what's important to them. And these are not things that happen overnight. It's been taking years, and it's work that just basically has to continue. I don't really think there's like a start date and a finish date to this work. It's community engagement. It's constantly assessing your school needs, your student needs, your family needs, and making sure that all of those needs are elevated, and especially our students that are living in temporary housing, students with disabilities, our English language learners. Those voices really need to be at the top of those conversations when they're happening. I just wanna like give a shout out to Executive Superintendent Watts, because she has created spaces for district leaders to discuss problems that we're having in, and successes, of course. And I've heard that that is not happening all over New York City. I'm surprised to hear that. I absolutely think it's necessary, and I applaud her for starting these monthly meetings. And Superintendent Scop in District 15 created these incredible soup with the soup lunch specials, where they were small group sessions, and she was able to engage various community members about how they were doing during the pandemic. And I think that we actually see results from the conversations that we're having with our school leaders. And I know that is not happening in a lot of districts. And I think that we need to have some sort of accountability system in place that is stronger than what it is right now, that just really is able to identify where these disconnects are, because parents are volunteers, spend countless hours
Camille, you're muted. Well, you might have just lagged a bit.
No, I did get muted. I'm sorry. It was I must have touched something by mistake. But just to wrap it up, I just want to say that it's really important to be able to identify where these disconnects are happening, where the communication is falling apart, because without the communication, without like the safe space to tell our stories and listen to people, and that all takes time, empathy, sympathy in some cases, to do it with kindness and love and an open heart. And sometimes I'm a little bit Pollyanna-ish, but thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you, Camille. Thank you for naming that District 15 is a very different space than some of the other spaces in our communities, and kind of just contextualizing that in the context of desegregation. Because we see District 15 being celebrated, but we know that District 15 is not the only district to attempt to desegregate. And we have to think about where our energy and effort is being put as a city, and who needs our support the most. and what we can do to really have a conversation, right? And not just about desegregating, but about all the steps that we need to take to make desegregation safe for our most impacted learners. I also love what you brought up about accountability. I don't know that other districts have had the experience that you have had. I actually think that is probably the most pressing issue in this pandemic year. And in the context of segregation, we've only in the past couple of years even started naming segregation as an issue of educational equity. And while I'm excited about the intention to talk about it, to dismantle segregation, segregation is a pretty easy word to use these days, right? All the words that go with the segregation are difficult. And I see some really good conversation going on in the chat just about what it looks like to support folks in this work and what it looks like to really name things. And I see, I just wanna go back and kind of amplify a couple of things because I'm sure they're shared in the space. It's absolutely important to confront and own the racist nature of our current DOE and curriculum. But my experience with addressing these issues is that as soon as you focus on racism, people get defensive. Some people feel like they will be blamed, and some are actively looking for people to blame. The result is the opposite of intent. The community becomes polarized. How do we address the racism in a way that brings people together and looking forward to a better ed system? So Lisa, thank you for amplifying this, because I think this is a concern that a lot of people come to the table with. I think that the framing is off here, right? Because if we are saying that communities of color are most impacted and suffer because of these systems, we can't also say, let's find a polite way to have this conversation about the suffering of the majority of our city's children. And so I think one of the really important things that we have to do as folks who are invested in anti-racism is get comfortable with being uncomfortable and encourage folks in our circles to do the same. You're not going to be comfortable addressing racism. I can assure you that Black and Brown and low-income Asian people and disabled folks and their parents are not super comfortable when these things come up. We don't enjoy discussing racism. We don't enjoy discussing systemic inequity, but we have no choice because lives and futures are on the line. So when you put that up against someone's discomfort because they feel bad or because they feel wrong, I think it's clear what should be the priority, right? And we have to have these grown adults, our parents, our educators, our administrators, and everyone in between, right? Because these are things that we ask of children, and children do them. Students want to have these conversations. They get excited about talking about what's going on in the world because they're already seeing it and they're already being impacted by it. So for us as adults to show up to the table and say, let's figure out how to do this in a nice way, we're doing ourselves and our children a disservice. And in a year like this year, we really don't have the time. The stakes are too high, y'all, to figure out how to do this in a way that's not going to hurt anyone's feelings, because Black and Brown children are hurting and we're not figuring out a nice way to make the system better for them, right? That's not where our priority is or has been. There are children in New York City who still don't have devices, children who have to translate for their parents because we haven't done our job to make language justice a reality, right? And so when we think about all of those systemic things that families have experienced for decades, I hope that that would make it really clear that our priority can't be anyone's comfort before the most impacted students, educators, and families' comfort. So that being said, I actually want to pass this question to Miriam, just about thinking about support, right? What does structural support look like? We have a lot of administrators, we have educators here, but we also have parents, we even have a couple students. What does DOE support look like in service of student voice and true parent partnership, rather than the performative engagement that only reaches a handful of parents? And what is at stake if there is no inclusive, accessible outreach and collaboration with our most deeply impacted families?
So I resume this question to support, basically bringing support to the families And I jump back to the previous question where Camille said that we have to have a welcoming environment. Everything starts with that welcoming environment. And as I said, I have been through different schools, public schools from Brooklyn South. And because my kids were gifted and talented, and therefore we were sent to the school that was assigned to them. And I discovered different, different environment. And some of the schools let me be included in the group, and I felt supported. And some of the schools were totally, there was a wall. So I think that we have to start by the welcoming environment, and we have to start by within the schools, have a place for the families, where the families who are English speakers or non-English speakers can come and really communicate with admin and teachers. Because having appointments and trying to make appointments, sometimes it works, most of the time it doesn't work. Everybody is very busy. But if there is, and maybe this is too, it's too utopic to think that in every school we could have a space where admin could meet the teachers and teach, admin could meet the parents and parents could meet the teachers as well. There are some schools that are wealthy and they have, what is it called, a family room or a family center within the schools, within the public school. And they are doing very well. And the communication is very well, even with the families that need a translator or need translation, etc. As a matter of fact, in District 15, I can give the example of 261, perfect example. Many Yemeni families, etc., the access is perfect. So, this is my humble view, and that's how I, this is also coming from my experience. And I think that everything starts there. And then establish communication and having an open communication. And let the parents know and let the families know. The wealthy families have access automatically. Somehow they will have access. But the immigrant, the minorities, wherever I am, I will ask the question. At noon, I was in a shop in Midwood trying to get my, sorry, I'm gonna be quick, my screen of the phone being repaired. So the gentleman, Malik, tells me, okay, you can come back at 4. At 2 o'clock, I have to pick up my siblings from PS217. And I was like, oh, PS217, how is it going there? How do you feel about gentrification? What do you think? Are you having access? Are you participating at the level of the SLT or the PTA? He knew nothing about PTA. He knew nothing about SLT. What mattered to him was the communication with the teacher. And he immediately showed me his telephone with the text that the teacher was sending him about his twins, brother and sister at PS217. So being a brown family, he didn't know. He had no knowledge about the whole, how he could be supported within the school. So I think we have to do a lot of outreach. We have to do a lot of communication. Level of the many, many families. I'm now switching to Fort Greene, a very well-to-do school, Clinton Hill, PS20. Many families do not know how is the DOE constructed and who is the superintendent, don't know who is executive. So we need a lot of communication and education of the families. In order to give them access, total access. That's what I think.
Thank you so much, Miriam. I'm really happy that there's a lot of people on the call that seem to have had some positive experiences in their individual schools and districts. And that makes me happy because that's important. I think for the purpose of this conversation and what we can bring back to our individual communities. I would love for everyone to, I encourage you all to just think big, think systemic, think district-wide, citywide, so that we can really be able to pull out kind of those threads of what's not working across our community so that we can work on the things that are not working. Yes, we want to celebrate what is working, and I'm glad about it, but I think it's just important to keep that context. The next question, Taj, is someone trying to...
Yeah, Taj, I just want to add something if I can.
Absolutely.
You know, we continue to hear, you know, we heard Dr. Marion talk about it. We've also heard, I believe Camille talk about SLTs and the importance of SLTs. And I think that, you know, in order for us to do anything within the system in a local school building, that's what has to function first. That's what have to function properly. And what the biggest thing that I've seen is that principals have to not, you know, I think sometimes they get scared of when you're a vocal parent and you know a little bit, and that's where the pushback, but they have to, we have to begin to make sure from the top, from central on down, that we are empowering our principals to empower our parents, because we can get all the empowerment, all the training, all the development from FACE. And when we get into our local districts, into our local schools, and we begin to uplift what we've learned, that's where we begin to get the pushback. And I think that's, you know, we have to begin to identify these things and begin to talk about them. And don't begin, you know, so when you talk about something or you don't agree with something, it don't mean you're adversarial. It doesn't mean you hate the school. It doesn't mean any of that. It means you want best for your child. And when we all get to the same page that we all want best for our children, that's when we're going to see the system move forward. That's when desegregation and all of those things are going to matter. Until then, we can continue to talk in circles, but it has to start locally. It has to start at the school level. And we have seen too many times when parents are vocal and parents push it, they become the person that they push to the side. They become the person that's the problem. They become the person that, you know, nobody wants to deal with. And that's what we have to uplift. And that's what we have to push. And SLTs is the way to get all of these things that we want done, because the superintendent can put out a demand, but if that principal is not willing to follow it, it goes nowhere. So making sure that SLTs are functioning properly is the first way to make sure we can desegregate schools.
Thank you so much, Nick. And just to that point, like providing tangible support when the SLT is not functioning properly, because in that same vein of what Naquan just shared about parents being ostracized for trying to move this work forward, the system also becomes a barrier when folks decide that they won't help in a meaningful way, right? If your SLT loses teachers, for example, because you have very vocal parents that are talking about anti-racism, what is the structural support system that exists to address that issue and to allow the SLT to function so that it can do good work? And what are the ramifications, right? What does it look like to hold accountable the individuals who do not want to invest in this work? Because that's what a lot of us are really saying without saying it, right? I want to move the work forward, but there's this barrier. Sometimes the barriers are our peers. Sometimes the barriers are our superiors. And what does it look like systemically to have an answer for that, and not an answer that is not sufficient for the times we are living in and the families that are most impacted? I did see some hands up and I want to leave a little time at the end, but I do want to make sure that I'm prioritizing our panelists. And there was one more question I wanted to get to before we close. We got to it a little bit, but I would love to hear some tangible solutions that I'm certainly sure that my parents have. Naquan touched on this really well. In the context of integration and violent pushback, what is necessary to protect Black, Brown, disabled, Asian, English language learner, undocumented, and low-income students? And what do school leaders need to do to prepare? And I'm going to hand that off to Erica first. Erica, I'm just checking in. but she may have something going on. I can pivot to Abby. The Zoom God's hating on us, y'all. Are we having some difficulty? No worries if we are. While Erica and Abby, they might have stepped away or sorting out their audio, I will pass it back to Naquan. What, in the context of integration and violent pushback, which a lot of people are bringing up in the chat, right? Pushback to trying to move this work forward. What is necessary to protect our most vulnerable students? And how do school leaders prepare for that?
I think what's necessary is, I'm excited. One part I'm excited because I believe that one of the things that the DOE have in place, and I'm not just saying this because Sadie's on, but I'm excited around FACE and the structure of FACE. And that is one of the tools that the system can use that's right there now that has an opportunity to go into, we have, you know, within Sadie's team, I believe she has a student voice person. It's allowing all of these people that the DOE already have in place to integrate into communities. You know, I said it earlier, the things come from the top. The chancellor says it, it goes to the executive superintendent, it leads from the executive superintendent, it gets to the superintendent, and it goes to schools and it drops. Because there's so many schools and so many different things that people have different ways of looking at stuff. The pushback that we have seen in districts like 14, in districts like 20, in districts like 28, in districts like 20 and 26 and 25 and 24, when parents begin to speak out about inequities, it's disgusting. And it always begin to churn on, because we're Black, we're angry, because we wanna voice the way we concern, because we wanna live. I just wanna live. I don't wanna walk outside and be shot. I just want my kids to be able to go to school and learn. This system, which is the biggest system in the country, don't have the ability to work with students with dyslexia, which is a common disability. There's a problem. And until the department identify that they have a problem, they're not gonna move forward. But I would say to parents, I know that sometimes it is hard, but continue to push, continue to be the troublemaker, for lack of better words, to get this done. Because if we be silent, the thing is going to continue. We will not move anywhere. So I would say, let's use FACE to help uplift the inequities within our communities. But also we have to make sure that the people that are supposed to support us believe that they should be supporting us, believe that we should have the power to receive the support.
Naquan did not come to play today, honey. Thank you so much for naming that, because it's the fact of the matter is that families have been structurally disempowered and we genuinely forget that we have a say. Things roll down from the DOE or from an administrator and we say, okay, well, I guess I have to do this thing. And we're in a position where we forget that we can question things. As your child's first teacher, you get to ask questions. You get to show up to the school. You get to air your grievances and have concerns. And what should happen is that there's a partnership. And so there's a conversation and there's resolution after the conversation, right? We co-create a solution to the issues that we find. But oftentimes, that's not what families experience. They have a very top-down experience. And what engagement or quote-unquote communication looks like is, well, I emailed you back. You might not actually have your question answered or your issue resolved, but someone has a digital paper trail somewhere that says that they talked to you. And we have to understand that systemically, that doesn't do the job that our parents need to get done, and it doesn't serve our students in the best way possible. But I see that Erica is back, so I'm going to pass that question to Erica, and I'm also going to look in the chat to uplift some of what you guys are saying. Go ahead, Erica.
Yeah, so... in terms of, you know, like the pushback, you know, if there's one thing that I think that people need, they need community, right? Like you need to be able to talk to somebody else and hear them say, no, this is not normal. No, this is not okay. And if we need to pull up together somewhere next time, then that's what we'll do. And that's for two reasons, right? Because first and foremost, when somebody is private messaging you or trying to send you DMs somewhere, or they're, you know, sending you nasty messages, like that can shake you. That can absolutely shake you. And as somebody who just came because they really wanted to help children and they wanted to support families, to get messages telling you to go back where you came from, like, sir, my birth certificate actually says a state in the United States, right? Like in several generations of my family as a Black American, and I'm talking 8 or 9 generations, have birth certificates to some degree or some record that says that this is their country, right? So that doesn't mean much to me. But when somebody says something like that to you, and then it just gets aggressively and increasingly violent and hostile, and they're, you know, they're accosting you at public spaces, at rallies and events, you know, you need to be able to talk to somebody and say, I feel scared. I'm uncomfortable. I did not sign up for this. And you need to be able to have somebody respond to you and say, no, you didn't. What can we do? And then the we that has formed around the idea that there's going to be pushback to a conversation about empathizing with the realities of Black and Brown people, you take that to elected officials, because now you have a coalition. And now your coalition has to be about the business of creating, you know, community agreements on a broader scale that you can be penalized for violating. If you are going to operate in this space as a parent advocate, as somebody who was elected by a collective that said that they want you to represent them, that power and that responsibility can be removed from you if you violate this agreement, if you violate the terms of engagement here. You know, the understanding of what it means to do this work in community sometimes is watered down because we feel like we're getting so little done. But at the end of the day, now we're talking about segregation. Now we're talking about inequities because we've been able to come together and have these conversations and advocate together. You know, a lot of the work that I do with the ECC is around charter stuff. Please believe, had we not come together and passed a bunch of resolutions, it would not be clear to the people who actually vote on that matter at the state. It would be clear. It would not have gone all the way through. It would not have been clear to them how serious we are about that, were it not for a bunch of CECs coming together and making it clear. You know, we have been, because white supremacy is always going to do what white supremacy has always done, it is going to make us feel like our voices do not matter. So if me as an individual, my Black ass voice does not matter, sure enough, the collective of our Black ass voices too don't matter, right? So what's the point? Like, that is what we walk around feeling when we look at a community that has been divested from, when we come out of a building that a landlord is just kind of bilking money from and not investing in. We feel that our voices don't matter because we look around and say, well, if they did, why is nobody listening and doing something about this? And this could be whatever the hell it is you want to define it as, right? But because that's what white supremacy does, what we've always done is lift each other up. What we've always done is try to put a battery in each other's backs or recharge each other when we can. And that is why community really has to be the response to pushback. If you see somebody being mistreated, rally around them, go to them and say, I can't even understand what's going on. I'm sorry. I hate this. What can I do? How can I help you? How can I support you? What can we do? That is the best thing that you could do for somebody who is struggling. You don't abandon them. You definitely don't walk away from them. You don't say, oh, that's not my business. I stay out of that. No, you say, no, I got you. What can I do? Do I need to show up? How, and if so, how can I show up for you in that way? You might not get everything that you want, but at least you have somebody that can validate for you the reality of what you're experiencing and how wrong it actually is.
I told y'all I was obsessed with Erica when we started this here forum, did I not? Because this is why. Thank you for grounding us in the reality of structural racism, right? Because we use words and sometimes we forget the gravity, y'all. We say things like learning loss and segregation and anti-racism and diversity and inclusion and equity. And we use these words day in and day out, but sometimes we forget that these words describe the lived experiences of human beings and that this work was never easy. And it was never without pushback. And it was never 100% of the population that was invested and ready to go in service of the humanity of Black people, of Latinx people, of low-income Asian people, of disabled people. This was never something that everybody was fighting for, but there's enough of us, y'all. There's enough of us, y'all, to create a transformational shift. But we have to be invested in, like Erica was saying, too, we have each other's backs. I wanted to stop briefly because I saw some hands up. And if we have the time and if my panelists don't mind, I would love to honor that and give a couple of our parents who are attendees today the floor, if that's okay. Can I just get a like a thumbs up if my panelists are okay with me letting a few of our other parents speak before we leave each other? I see Naquan's thumb up, okay. Okay, Camille. Appreciate you guys. Thank you so much, y'all. I see you. Okay, so with that, I'm gonna pass it to Naomi.
Hi, everyone. I want to thank everyone for allowing this space to exist. I think it is helpful. I just want to sort of mention something that has been really prevalent lately. And one of the things has been like, what do we do? The whole concept about parent engagement and what does that mean and what the consequences are. You know, you have two spectrums. You have the, like it was mentioned before earlier, where there was a parent that really just cares about teacher. Like, I just want to know where my child is. And then there's people who like really want to get involved. And all of, you know, those of us who've been in this work, like really care about it from a more wider lens, not just about my kid, but uplifting all of our kids. And what's going to end up happening is that if there is no additional support for those of us who are actually doing the work for free, we're just going to bow down and leave because, you know, we have a plate that runneth over on many different scales between work and life and, you know, our families. And we take this on as another burden because we really care and we really want to do, we want what's right for our communities. But oftentimes when we're left hang to dry, it doesn't feel like you're supported. So it's nice to have these circles, but what's going to end up happening is that there's going to be more of people who feel that way. Just like, I'm exhausted, like straight up, I'm exhausted. And no one is lifting me up, and that's fine. But after a while, I'm going to check out, and I don't know where the rest of my district's going to be. And then you're going to have more people who are going to check out. And then what? Then you're going to have the loudest people in the room who don't have the best interests in our families to want to do what's right. And I think, you know, if we're going to talk about white supremacy, like, is that the intent? Is that the intention that we don't want families of color to be involved because we really want to uplift those who make the loudest noises and can get a lawyer really quickly? Or do we really want to do what's right? You know, and I take a reference from the great Tupac, who has said once, you know, people were talking smack about his music and how violent it was. And he literally said, you know, You will, if someone is hungry and they're outside of a buffet, you knock gently and say, hey, I'm here, I'm hungry, can I have some food? Then you ask again, and then it's going to get a little bit more aggressive, and then more aggressive, and it's going to be to the point where I'm not going to say please, I'm going to kick down the door, shoot everyone up, and take your food out of your mouth. And not that we're going to do that, but, you know, there's going to reach a frustration level that is going to topple off, and we're just going to fall back and say enough. And that is something that we need to be cognizant of because, you know, we only have a lifespan of X number of years in this sort of system, right? And I want to make sure that anyone that does engage in that is having a good experience in it. But I will tell you, when Aquan is uplifting all these, you know, 20X-ish districts who are doing this type of work or not work to keep the status quo, it's the disengaging. If I lived in a district, I would never jump in those spaces. For what? To be attacked? To be marginalized? Hell no. I can stay in the corner of my house and do that all my own with my own kids, right? Let them attack me because they do that well. But you know, I think these are just things that we need to be cognizant of, because at some point you can only ask so much of a parent when you're stretched out thin and you, and there's no supports to uplift you. And if there's no supports to uplift you, you're not going to get very far. And the work is going to stay stagnant like it has been for the last 60 years in the city. Thanks.
Thank you, Naomi. Next, I'm going to call on Craig.
Oh, wow. I wasn't expecting that. Blessings, everyone. I hope you and your families are well. Peace and respect to those who are struggling. I'm the proud co-president of the Citywide Council for District 75 and the SLC member for 75K771, the School of Superheroes. I lift up everything in terms of what Naquan was saying, the frustration that Naomi mentioned. I'm sorry, the Hindu sister that mentioned, I want to go back to what the Hindu sister mentioned in reference to the gentleman that had to cut short the service that she was getting to pick up the kids that were in school. It starts there. I'm always trying to foster communication because District 75 has a 40 to 50 year reputation, well, maybe not 50 years, 40 years, in terms of being the garbage pail kids. And that in correlation to the 400, 500 years of capitalism against those Black people and other people of color, it's gonna take a while to fight this. And I wanna be forceful in terms of it takes parents to say what they mean, but I also wanna lift up the fact that it's hard. This oppression is hard, especially for parents with disabilities, and start small. How do you eat an elephant? One bite at a time. It's large. It's easy for us to say, but I want to go back to those parents. I was in that situation in terms of my wife and I, in terms of how are my kids going to fit in with a gen ed? Where's our identity? We started with small conversations. Go back to the small conversations. Look for like people, like parents, the teachers. Start small. It's not going to be big. You can't do it all at once. Start small and link that with what the PTA, when is the PTA scheduled to meet? When is the CEC scheduled to meet? If you're on a citywide council, if you speak a different language, when is CCEL being to meet? Special education, when is that being to meet? And District 75, hopefully the next council will break off and break into boroughs and break down the communication to barriers so that could be more together. So start small and look at those schedules and hold those folks accountable in your schools and on the CEC. Parent elections, the 1st to the 11th of May, hold those people accountable. God bless you all.
Thank you so much, Craig. And thank you for bringing that reminder to the space that, you know, small is all. On one hand, yes, we want to make sure we aren't centering comfort over transformational systemic change. But on the other hand, if you're one parent and you get one more parent to show up at that PTA meeting and amplify the needs of special needs student during a public comment section, that's the work. If you get two more parents to show up at the SOT, even though they can't speak, but they're there in the space and then they have the information and they're able to follow up via email with your principal and ask important questions. And so now you have a paper trail that you can refer to when you ask your next questions in 2 weeks, if you don't get a response, that's also the work. Sometimes parents might feel it's intimidating. The parent leader space is intimidating in general. Being a parent in New York City is intimidating in general. Being a parent during a pandemic and, you know, trying to navigate your own grief and anxiety and navigate your child's grief and anxiety and your loved ones. And if you're a parent leader, you're trying to hold the community on your back. So it's a lot. So I really appreciate Craig just kind of reminding us that those relationships matter. And building from the bottom matters, and building with the folks right next to you, because that's how it all starts. All those districts that you might see and you're like, man, they're doing it big. I wish I lived in that district. That was just a couple people when they started. That was just a couple folks. but they built and they built and they kept showing up. So thank you, Craig. I think what Craig said and what Naomi said are such important pieces of the puzzle. I appreciate you guys so much. I am going to have to run soon. So I just want to warn you guys, Sadie's going to be taking over. I have to run and be with my babies at Teens Take Charge. But I do want to make sure that I allow Superintendent Scott to speak. I saw your hand and thank you so much for waiting patiently while I made sure that we amplified all of our parents. But we would love to hear from you.
But before you do, because we don't want to lose you yet, Taj, if everybody could just give even just like a little clap emoji, or if you want to get off mute real quick, but just please hold space for our beloved and astounding leader, Taj, who seems to always have the word.
Yeah, Taj, pulling it down.
Bravo, Taj. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Love you.
Thank you. I appreciate it. I love you too. I'm very, very thankful and grateful. And I know I be coming in hot, but that's only because I love these kids and I love my community and our communities. And I think the thing I want to leave you with today is question anyone who is not fighting for all of our children. Question anyone whose policy, whose attitudes, whose behaviors, whose beliefs are not rooted in the ability to thrive for all of our children. Question any policy that does not leave room for the most marginalized babies among us. If we are all doing that collectively, we can't lose. I'm going to hand it over to Superintendent Scott. Thank you, guys.
Thank you, Taj. I would like to speak for people who don't have a voice, who oftentimes are too frightened to come to meetings, who are too frightened to come and use technology. And I want to speak for the immigrant, the undocumented immigrant families in my district who literally are so afraid of deportation, of what will happen to them, that they literally, in many cases, are fearful to use technology because they're afraid they will be traced through the technology. They are afraid to raise their voices because they don't want to be noticed and called out. They have such confidence and connection to their schools that they do connect to their principals. They do connect to their teachers, their parent coordinators, but they are voices that are fearful of being heard. And so I think it is excruciatingly important that we understand that there are some people who will be afraid to make their voices heard, and that sometimes it behooves us who have the power to use our voices to speak in their behalf. And that's just what I wanted to remind you of, because the beauty of this meeting and the beauty of the people here is because they are speaking for all of our children and not just for a select group. So thank you for that. And I ask that you please remember those people who simply can't take the risk.
Thank you so much, Superintendent Scott, 100,000,000%. Think another thing, y'all know I can never shut up, right? Just thinking about the intersections, right? Because a lot of our Black and Brown students are also immigrant, are also undocumented, many of whom also have IEPs, right? So connecting these fights and fighting alongside one another has never been more critical. Thank you for amplifying that community specifically, because as with all of our marginalized identities, there are going to be barriers. There are going to be very specific things that we need to be mindful of so that we can advocate in the safest and most impactful way possible. So thank you so much, Superintendent Scott. I'm going to jump off now and hand it over to Sadie. I appreciate you all. Keep fighting, keep moving. And to our folks in structural seats of power, I got to fuck shit up too. From the inside and the outside. We got you if you got us. Let's get it.
There is really nothing worse than coming after Taj. So I'm gonna try to just move us along. I appreciate that. I'm sitting here with multiple hats on and I'm just sort of in awe of what parent leadership looks like in action. And so when you ask yourselves, like, what's possible, like, everybody can do this at their school level. Everyone can do this with their homies, their friends. We can all just keep replicating this and keep modeling it. And you guys are doing such a beautiful job. There are a few other questions I wanted to sort of ground us in. But before we get to them, I thought we could do a quick round robin of all of the panelists, you know, sort of 30 seconds or to 1 minute or less, like, we're trying to be in the future. We hear a lot about what we don't need. The pain of what we've lost and what we're encountering as a society is ever present. It's evergreen in all of our day-to-days, especially as we're caregiving with our kids and our dogs jumping all over us all at the same time. What do we want to see come September? What is, like, the asset-oriented policy that we want to instill for our policymakers and for ourselves? Let's start with Naquan.
I would just say that we want to see true parent empowerment. Not only when you all need us to do stuff, but true parent empowerment. We want to be a part of how we're reopening school. I think it's the top thing on our minds.
I agree with, I agree with Naquan. Empowerment, parent empowerment, it's something that the first time that I heard the previous chancellor, Carranza, talking to the parents, when he said, I do not want only to have the parents engaged, I would like to empower the parents. I jumped on my seat, and this is exactly what it means. So empowering the parents and talking to the parents and making sure that we have open line of communication, that we are really in sync, and for the the interest of the families and the students. And there are many examples lately that we're not, we could see that we are not in sync. We're being kept in the dark, and all of a sudden things happen. And even the principals, they learn things on Twitter. So open line of communication, super transparency, super communication. And the DOE giving, it's from the DOE level. I just want to, from the DOE level, he's saying something. Naquan, you said you're muted. Oh, he was saying something. Oh, so from the DOE, it has to come from the DOE, and the DOE has to be able to give, to let all voices be heard. I hope I was not too long. Sorry, Zanny.
No, you're good. I just, you know, it's sometimes a stretch to be like, what exactly do we want to see? And I often inside the DOE hear a lot of, like, let's get academic rigor, let's get excellence, and then we'll get to equity, and then we'll get to social justice. And I'm one of many people trying to experiment towards what does institutionalizing social justice habits look like. And so that's what I meant, you know, with this question. Erica.
Yes. Repeat the question again. I'm simultaneously listening to my kids fuss at each other and trying to tap in.
what do we want to see for the fall? Like, what are the things we want the DOE to hear? What do you want to see for your kids in the fall? Like, what are we fighting against, but what are we, like, what do we want to actually see? Take us to that future together.
Yeah. So I think it would be empathy. I think that we have to really consider where it is that families are right now in this moment, and then move in the spirit of addressing what families need and recognizing their concerns, so that they actually feel like we all, like, everyone at the table is somebody that they want to share a table with. Right? Because if all we're talking about and all we hear about from a brand new chancellor is open, I can tell you that my community and communities, like, east of me, were terrified. because we're not ready to send our children back, because we still have people in our families, in our buildings, and in our communities dying. So if what you're about to tell me is that you're about to talk about forcing my child to go back into the building, what I'm probably going to tell you is I'm probably filling out homeschool paperwork. I'm probably thinking of ways in which to organized to undermine the idea of a successful reopening, because how dare you try to force me to accept a situation that we're still suffering from. So any decision that has to be made, first and foremost, has to be made from a position of empathy and understanding where we are as a community, not just Crown Heights, not just, you know, Brownsville or East Flatbush, but as a city. People are still going to the hospital. We still have family members who are coming out of the hospital and are still dealing with the side effects of long COVID. Absolutely not. Are you about to tell me where my children have to go? My children don't have to do anything but their chores. So at the end of the day, some kind of empathy and acknowledging where people actually are so that they can move to a place where they feel comfortable, like at a table making, at a table where decisions are made, to the point where the feedback that they give would actually be respected and recognized in the decisions that are made.
Whew. That's very, very real. That's very, very real. Someone made not alluded to the fact that a lot of us were getting a lot of our information from tweets. And I was one of those folks for sure. And I'm sure Superintendent Scott was at times as well. And it's demoralizing and demeaning, and whew, that's real. Abby, what would you like to see for our future in this sort of part three of our segregation in our city schools? What are we trying to see in our city schools?
I would like to see more communication, more trust, and I also would like to see not just bring your child to the door and say, parents, you can leave. I would like to see more welcoming, because it's not welcome at all at the school.
That's fair. And Camille?
I'm just reading everything that's in the chat, and you know, there's so much weight here. I was thinking about like how the prospect of a central communication system should happen, and the realities that exist, just elevating what Superintendent Scott said about families who are very, very fearful and anxious about sharing their information and being tracked. And those are real things. So I remember the day that schools were closing a year ago in March, and watching television, listening to the mayor and Chancellor Carranza. And Chancellor Carranza had said in that very, very first conversation that everybody needs to sign up for the NICSA account, and that there would be a line of central communication coming out of that. And it's a good idea in theory, and we might get there someday. I mean, we're moving in that direction. In some ways, we're forcing it in that direction, but we may never be at 100% participation. And so, you know, I think it's important to have a conversation about what is the number that we need to get to for that central communication to actually begin. And, you know, who is left out of that, and how do we prioritize getting the information to the people who are not connected?
I appreciate you guys. And also in my sort of quest to be like, hey, what does the future hold? Almost all of you sort of grounded all of us here on the Zoom in what the heaviness of the presence, and that maybe we're just not, we can't ignore or deny the heaviness of the present right now.
And we can't just sort of jump to what we want to see ideally, even though sort of that's where my optimist brain wants to go. If we're just not being honest about the sort of pain we're all sitting with. And so we have a couple minutes left. Does anybody from the audience have any questions? If so, please put them in the chat. I just gave you guys a shout. Otherwise, I'm gonna just have the amazing panel go around and sort of do a closing out to this group in the spirit of what Taj was saying. Small is all. Right now, right here in this here Zoom room, we're practicing a multiracial democracy. We're practicing centering parent voice. And so that's pretty cool. That's a win for the day. We got a long way to go. We can't do it without one another. So I'm not seeing any questions pop up going once. Okay, I'll see if anybody else chimes in. But otherwise, let's just have you guys, panelists, go around one more time and sort of just say your closing thoughts, something that you may have wanted to share, something that you want to sort of leave with, especially maybe grounding back into that this is part three of a teach-in about segregation in New York City schools, and maybe a force to try to be in a different future that's less segregated in New York City, but maybe not. Megan asked a great question. Can any of this change happen while under a system of mayoral control? We have a mayoral election in June. So great question. So if you want to take part of that or just have closing remarks for the crew, Miriam, or maybe we'll do Naquan circle protocol, just as we did. Naquan.
First. Okay. So I think closing, what I will want to see and say first is we have to self-care. When you hear Naomi talk about being burnt out, that's real. So really taking time for yourself and all the advocacy that we do, you have to self-care. To the larger point, yeah, you know, for those of you who have not listened to, School Colors is a good podcast to listen to really figure out and here around when you want to talk about mayoral control and could this ever happen under a mayor like the one we currently have, I think listening to School Colors will give you an idea. We can put any chancellor, and I'm excited for Misha. We can put any chancellor we want in that role. But if we have the same mayor who is not interested in desegregating, who is not interested in empowering parents, it could be done. But it will be hard. So it's having meetings like this and coming together in community like this that can push the envelope. So I will say to my colleagues that is on this call to keep up the good fight of faith and let's make sure that we're taking care of ourselves. Because if you don't take care of yourself, you'll be no good for anybody else.
Give me a thumbs up on this call or a little signal if you have felt burnt out or are feeling burnt out or are losing your mind completely. Yeah, we got to hold that. And yet here we are showing up in community with one another, but it's like, y'all, we're all holding so much. It's love all around. Miriam.
In closing, there's so much we can explore and we can talk about. Someone was talking and spoke about the children and the student, and we wanted the student to be hurting. This is exactly what the person said. And I think that exactly what's happening right now, there is a lot of pain, and the student being, many families being still in remote, being separated from their environment, from the school, from the teacher, from their lives. That was their life, and everything, you know, because of the pandemic is missing. We need to concentrate also on the students and how to provide the support for the remote families. Remote families, whatever they are, the wealthy, the well-to-do, the have, the not have. I just want to say, I was in a park and something happened between a group of kids who are currently going back to school, the in person, and a group of kids who were remote. And the meeting was not good because the kids who were in remote were missing the attention, wanted to interact, etc. And it just didn't work. So we need this social emotional, and we need to think of the kids, not to forget the kids.
Please don't forget the kids. Thank you. Who came after that? Was that Abby? Or was Erica, did Erica then Abby? Erica?
Erica's
here. Who's gonna unmute first?
No, I was trying to figure out. I was holding back to see
Zoom because we can't do a visual cue anymore, a body language cue. So it's a Zoom.
I know. I'm sorry. It's just because my daughter's rolling around here in a unicorn onesie, and I'm like, man, and nobody needs to see that. I've seen enough of it for the last 360 some odd days. Nobody needs that. I think the one thing that I think would be kind of be my closing thought would be the desegregation conversation actually makes me really uncomfortable as somebody who's a part of a district that is predominantly Black. A lot of the solution to everybody else's desegregation problem is just to try to find a way to import District 17's kids into their district. And as a thing that I say often is that just sounds like a divestment from Black educators, Black communities, and Black schools. We are not talking about importing white kids to Crown Heights. That's never, ever, ever been the option. That has literally never, ever been the conversation. It's never been the discussion, which basically just kind of implies that people don't necessarily feel that it's worth it. That people don't really feel like they would want to come, like they would just divest from the New York City schools altogether if that was the option. And I can't, like, this is how racism ultimately winds up creating systems like this. Well, nobody wants to come to Crown Heights. Nobody wants to come to East Flatbush. So, you know, we'll just find a way to import those kids elsewhere. And then we look at communities like mine and wonder why those schools are under-enrolled, or why, you know, there aren't as many programs, because the schools can't always afford them, because people keep finding ways to spirit our kids elsewhere. I really wish that conversations about equity and making sure that every school has got just as much play as conversations around desegregation, because desegregation is not Crown Heights' problem. And the problem that Crown Heights has, nobody actually is really invested in addressing because it's expensive. And that's the thing that really is not said. Equity costs money, money that people do not want to give, money that people do not feel they should have to give. That's their problem. That's not our problem. Our culture values, blah, 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 blah. Our culture values education. Every culture values education. But if a policy is creating a situation where some have and some do not, and solving that problem costs money, it is the moral obligation of the community to fix that. So desegregation is a problem, yes, but so is equity. So I would really want people to think about what we're saying when we say desegregate schools, desegregate communities, and think more about what it would look like to invest equally in everybody's school. Every community school. You invest equally in the schools, the school communities desegregate themselves. That might be to the detriment of other issues in the community, but everything else falls into place if every school has. Every school has an after-school program. Every school has arts. Every school has resources that invest fully and rigorously in each child. So I guess that would be my takeaway, is to think that equity deserves just as much lip service as desegregation does, because the District 15 has done beautiful, amazing, incredible work, and kudos to Camille and her crew for that. I'm looking forward to the conversation around equity getting just as much airtime.
Thank you. Abby?
Yes, my closing remarks will be by having outside organizations bring important topics and activities focused on culture and current events, and also allow students to have these conversations will enhance their knowledge and will be a treat to self or a treat with world communication. And also the approach to education is that addressing students' learning, social and emotional needs, and crucial, especially in times of crisis, dealing with this pandemic and this COVID-19, is that students from diverse backgrounds who are more at risk of increased vulnerability are less likely to receive the support and extra services they need, and the gap between students that experience additional barriers and that do not might widen.
Thank you so much. Camille.
Thank you. I'm just so happy and proud to be in this space. And, you know, I want everybody to know in those moments where you're just feeling down, like, look at all of these names on this call, and you probably know a big handful of them. Write them down. Don't forget who they are, because we're all sort of in this together and making a big commitment to every single child. What I want to say, and we talked about this a little bit in part two, but we didn't really hit it at all in session three, is that, you know, there's a host of policies that have been made that have caused segregation in our schools. But there are some policies in our schools right now that are forcing segregation that we can change. And we know what they are. They're around screens, they're gifted and talented, they're the specialized high schools, you know, you know them all. And we and the state tests. So we're in this moment where people are finally waking up and realizing that these tests should not be happening. I mean, parents are being allowed to opt in now, but they just shouldn't be happening, period. So I just want to tell everybody who is supporting the removal of screens and doing away with these tests that just are, you know, so racist. Kudos to you. Keep the faith. Keep going and walk the path. We're walking it together.
I don't think anyone could say it any better than a parent leader themselves. Let's let the parent leaders on this panel get a big round of applause from the audience, please. You can come off mute. Thank you for, woo! Yeah, that's right. Thank you. Give a little applause there.
Beautiful, beautiful.
Your energy. We are committed to doing better. So Craig, looking forward to even creating a more inclusive presentation. Count on bureaucrats for Black lives to always be in service of all children and dismantling any system that privileges any child over the other. And as your new executive director of FACE, this wasn't intended to be my first public appearance, but also I'm 1000% in service of you. And so I want to just talk about it. I want to be about it. And that's it. Have a beautiful, beautiful afternoon, everybody. Onwards we go. All power to the people.
Stay safe, everybody. Thank you for everything.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Bye.
Say to you, a beautiful soul, having this space for us. More to come. Oh, see. Now I got to dance while I'm working. What? Party over here.
Have a great day, everybody.
I can't wait till we actually get a chance to meet up in the place. It's going to be the club after a parent meeting. It's going to be hot to death.
Thank you all.
You're on fire.
Sadie.
Rhythm, I will be there.
Woo! On fire.
Sadie.
Yes.
So many people signed in under my name, Jimmy Brown.
Jimmy, is it? Who's the real Jimmy Brown?
The one with just the letter J, Jimmy Brown. I'm the J. I'm speaking to you now.
Thank you.
You got a picture of Siobhan. You got Dr. Cody using.